Good morning. Bienvenue. Bienvenue à tous et à tous. My name is Nancy Ross. I'm the Vice Principal of Research at Queen's University. Our morning program is about to start. I'd like to first invite our Associate Vice Principal, Ganeshandi John Hill, to provide an opening welcome and remarks about the land in which we are gathered this morning. So, Jan.
Sego sewa guego, wat kwanu horadu, kanu shuni yungyats, wagenyatu, dano ganyunge haga, gayente negede gidero, gundegi nidu wagenu, gundege gunnagari. In oral tradition, the Rodenoshoni open gatherings with the Ohandugari Wadekwa, the words that come before all business. It's spoken in the moment and from the heart, and usually tobacco is burned during the end of the recitation. We can't have a fire here, so there will be no tobacco. Also, I'm using notes so I don't miss anything. This ceremony acknowledges the importance and relationship of all entities in the natural world, from the earth to the sky world. It gathers the minds of the people together to extend greetings and gratitude to all of these elements, bringing everyone to a good mind before they turn to the business at hand. Gunjokwa, sabaduhusiyo ska nigariwesa. People, please listen for a short time. Ne egadi ohandugari wadekwa ungadi wanungode. The business will come to pass. Aguego unska, andidawatwe nuni ne ungwa nigura, dano dea tinawarado ne aguego. Everyone, we will bring our minds together as one and send our greetings to the people so that peace will continue for all of us. Aguego unska andidawatwe nuni ne ungwat nigura dano deyatinuwarado ne yeti nistoha jio wunjade jisego jatko wa hujes ago sadatstonsara na jun hyuhage. Everyone, we will bring our minds together as one and send our greetings to our mother, the earth, as she still goes along, giving of her own strength for us to live a good life. Aguego unska andidawatwe nuni ne unguat nigura dano deyatinuwarado ne aguego yunkiyenawase jiyo wunjade. Everyone, we will bring our minds together as one and send our greetings to all the things that support us on the earth. Aguego unska, indeed watwe nuni ne ungwa nigura, dano deyatinuwarado ne aguego yunki yenawase jit karunhyade. Everyone, we will bring our minds together as one and send our greetings to all of the things that support us in the sky and in the heavens. Dana onagadi, aguego. De chidwa nuwarado, ne sungwa adiso, ne gazatston soano, Sagoyera. And now we all send our greetings and our finest thoughts and wishes to the creator of all things, the great strength of the natural world. Eto ni oduhage ne ungwat nigura. And let it be so in our minds. And so now the words that have been come before all others have been shared, and we can turn our thoughts and our minds to the business at hand. At this time, it's normally my practice to invite everyone, anyone who's struggling or carrying burdens, to lay them down for the time that we're together and focus on the reason that we've gathered. It's your prerogative to pick them up on your way out if you choose, but I encourage you to leave them here for Zungwayat Dison, the Creator, to take care of for us. One of the other roles I play in my community is a clan mother in our longhouse, and so we understand that the land that we're standing on today is the ancestral land of the Haudenosaunee, the Anishinaabe, and the Huron-Wendat. In my role as clan mother, I'm honored to welcome you to this land on behalf of the chiefs, the clan mothers, the women, the warriors, the men, and the children, and the faith keepers. Enjoy your day, and thank you very much. Nyaogoa.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jan, for that welcome to the territory and reflections on where we gather together today. On behalf of the Principal and Vice Chancellor, Patrick Dean, and the entire Queen's community, it's my great pleasure to welcome everyone to our beautiful campus this morning. Please take some time to walk around and enjoy the beautiful surroundings. I'd like to recognize our distinguished speakers with us today, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, the Honourable François-Philippe Champagne, Minister of Innovation, Science and Industry, the Honourable Vic Fideli, who did step on my toe just as we walked in. It's fine, closed-toed shoes. The Minister of Economic Development, Job Creation and Trade for Ontario. He did apologize. And Matthias Miedrick, CEO of Umicore. Rick Brzee, MPP for Hastings, Lennox and Addington. Jim Hegedorn, Loyalist Township Deputy Mayor. I'd also like to recognize and welcome His Excellency Patrick Van Giel, the Ambassador of Belgium. Mark Gerritsen, Member of Parliament, Kingston and the Islands. His Worship, Brian Patterson, Mayor of Kingston. And our other honoured guests from the federal government, from the province of Ontario, the city of Kingston, and Loyalist Township. I so appreciate these concentric geographies. It is a particular pleasure to welcome you all here to Mitchell Hall. What a beautiful building, a home of discovery, innovation, and commercialization at Queen's. This wonderful building was opened 3 years ago with the support of both the federal and provincial governments, along with the generous donations from our private donors. The hard work that happens here in this building and across our campus is a result of the passion of our talented faculty, our researchers, and our students to make new discoveries and make an impact on our community. This impact is felt locally in our region, across Ontario, and throughout the country. On an annual basis, Queen's contributes more than $1.6 billion to this regional economy. That's 11% of the GDP between Belleville and Brockville. Queen's is, of course, an important partner for local business as a source of highly skilled talent. I'm hopeful today's announcement will bring some future relationships around talent, but also commercialization and innovation. We're also a resource to help companies grow, with the university's incubation and accelerator programs having supported more than 700 companies to date. And through our local partnerships, Queen's contributes to the health, the vibrancy, and the sustainability of the region we call home. That's why Queen's was extremely proud to be included for the past 2 years among the top 10 universities in the world on the Times Higher Education Impact Ranking for advancing the UN's Sustainable Development Goals. Thank you all for being here today. After this morning's announcement, I invite you to join us in the atrium for a brief reception. It's now my great pleasure to welcome the Right Honourable Justin Trudeau, Prime Minister of Canada, and invite him to take the podium for today's announcement.
Thank you, Nancy. Thank you, Jan, for your wonderful words of welcome. Bonjour tout le monde. Minister Champagne, François-Philippe, it seems like every time we're in Ontario, we have more big good news for the economy. We see Vic regularly on this as well for these announcements. Thank you for all the work you've done in demonstrating the strong partnership different orders of government can have working together and delivering for our citizens from coast to coast to coast. And I want to particularly recognize Matthias from Umicore for his confidence and faith in Canada. The investment today, as we'll talk about, is really a vote of confidence in Canadians, in our ability to step up and provide solutions, not just for ourselves, but for the world. And this is a recognition, yes, of government stepping up to partner, but it's also a recognition recognition of the extraordinary ability of Canadians to be part of solving global solutions, and thank you, Matthias, for recognizing that. I also want to obviously give a shout out to the local representatives here, RMP Mark Gerritsen, great to see you here, Mark. Also Mayor Pattison, Acting Mayor Hagedorn, and MP Breezy. Thank you very much, all of you, for being here. Being here at Queen's today reminds us all that the engine of our economy has always been Canadians' drive and talent, their desire and their abilities to work hard, to solve extraordinary challenges and to build a better future is what gathers them here today in this extraordinary institution, but indeed motivates Canadians from coast to coast to coast. I'm here today to harness that power of Canadian innovation and hard work by announcing that we've reached a deal with Umicore to build a new battery facility in Loyalist Township. This plant will supply materials for 1 million electric vehicles a year. Canada isn't just going to be a global player in EVs. With this and other announcements we've made, we demonstrate that we get to be global leaders in electric vehicles. This is big news. What does it actually mean for people here in the area and across the country? To begin with, 1,000 jobs during construction and hundreds of good long-term positions at the Loyalist plant once it's up and running. Et pour nous tous, l'annonce d'aujourd'hui veut dire de l'air plus propre grâce à des véhicules moins polluants et une économie et une industrie compétitive à l'échelle mondiale. Today's deal is just one of many, as we mentioned, we've reached this year. The numbers speak for themselves. Nearly 17,000 good jobs for Canadian workers to make hybrids, EVs, and EV batteries. Around $15 billion in investments between industry and governments in the Canadian economy, making that big bet that we can be the solution around electric vehicles and electric supply chains that the world is relying on. Quand on positionne le Canada comme un leader dans le domaine des véhicules électriques, c'est bon pour notre économie et c'est bon pour l'environnement. Ça nous montre qu'en agissant pour le climat, on bâtit de nouvelles industries canadiennes. C'est pour ça qu'on investit du début à la fin du cycle de fabrication des véhicules électriques. We're investing to build EVs with our critical minerals strategy and manufacturing deals. We're investing to buy EVs. On Monday, we launched a new incentive to help businesses buy an electric van or other big vehicles. And to charge EVs. This week alone, we're announcing funding for over 6,000 chargers across the country. Canadians have always been people who innovate. Today, we're reminded that that remains our path forward. With Canadian know-how, we can grow our economy and make life more affordable while leaving a bright future for our kids. C'est ça le Canada, qu'on continue de bâtir de façon positive et ambitieuse à tous les jours, ensemble. Je suis très content d'être ici avec vous pour cela. Et je passe la parole maintenant à mon ami, François-Philippe Champagne. Minister, the floor is yours.
Bonjour tout le monde. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Prime Minister. It's a real pleasure to be here at Queen's. Mr. President, Chancellor, thank you for welcoming us in your house this morning. Thank you, everyone, and thank you, Matthias. You know, I remember it's great to see you again because, as the Prime Minister was saying a moment ago, this is a key investment that will add a critical element to the North American batteries ecosystem. And as the Prime Minister said, we just don't want to be part of it. We want to lead it. And that's really what this is about this morning. I would say, Matthias, it's... We spent quite a bit of time together. I was looking at my text message, actually, when we first started to talk to each other. We spent a bit of time together in Europe. I think we met four times in Brussels. And we've been traveling across Canada together, actually. We were in Montreal just on the same stage yesterday. It just seems that every time we are a meeting, good things happen. So as I said to the Prime Minister, I already look forward to welcome you back in Canada, because every time we meet, there's some good news coming out of that. I still recall the very first text message that we sent each other. Actually, it was on January 10, 2022, at about 7:26 in the morning, in which I was telling you that I was keen to support you and your team for what was the proposed investment at the time, to which you responded within just a few hours to said, yes, we're going to do it. And I just want to say, here we are this morning. So it's been a great journey together. So Prime Minister, thank you for your leadership. Thank you for your trust. And thank you for your vision, which enabled us to become the green supplier of choice to the world. Some of you have seen I was in Japan, I think last week. Days goes fast these days. And I was saying that, and I was saying we can become the green supplier of choice, and I think this morning is a great example. Minister Fedeli, great to see you again, my friend. As we continue to attract significant investments in Ontario that will strengthen the auto sector for generations to come. To my dear friend Mark Gerritsen, where are you, Mark? You're slightly taller than me, I should be able to recognize you. Thank you for your support at every step of the way, my dear friend. Mark made sure that this was top of mind for me, and I can assure you that when Mark talks, people tend to listen. And I would say, Mark, thank you, because you've been instrumental, not only as the MP for Kingston and the Islands, but also as Parliamentary Secretary to the House Leader, a very key position in our government. So we're very pleased. And Mark, I kept him abreast as well by text message. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. So here we are this morning. I'd like to acknowledge also MP Shelby Cramp, which is with us. Shelby is just there. Shelby, pleasure to have you. Actually, Loyalist is in your riding, as I understand it. I was looking at the boundaries, but it's really in your riding. I want to say also, Deputy Mayor, thank you for your work, and I know you were there at critical moments to make that happen. I think there was one evening where we were all sweating, and we made sure that this would be happening. And to the ambassador, Ambassador, merci d'être là avec nous, évidemment, Monsieur l'Ambassadeur, c'est un plaisir, l'Ambassadeur de Belgique. To Rick Breeze, which is now the MPP. Rick, where are you? You're there. Thanks for playing a key role to bringing us across the finishing line, and only you know what I mean by that. And I appreciate you're here. And obviously to the Invest in Canada team. I think the Invest in Canada team is somewhere in the room. I should see them here in the back. And Katie Curran, which is the acting CEO. You have been doing a superb job, and I want to say that in front of national television. You've done a superb job in engaging with the team at Umicore, and yesterday when we had dinner was another testament of that, because Matthias and I, and his wife, which is blessing us with her presence, was, yes, here you are, you were blessing us with your presence. I think you could see that this was really a team effort, Prime Minister, and that's how it should be, because your success is our success as Canada. So I'm glad, as you can see, that we can all be together for what is a truly historic moment, a milestone, as the Prime Minister said. As you just heard from the Prime Minister, and you will hear from my friend, I think at this point we can call each other friend, Matthias, today we're announcing plans for a new manufacturing facility in Loyalist Township, right here in the Kingston region. And I'm proud because one of the things we've achieved, Prime Minister, is that the auto sector is spreading across the country now. It's not just concentrated, but now Kingston is going to be part of the auto sector in Canada, as much as we've done in Quebec as well, which is really good news for communities across Canada. And for all of those who are watching, this is just any kind of manufacturing facility. What we're announcing today will be a big part of the future of the auto manufacturing sector and of Canada's economy as a whole. An economy, as the Prime Minister stated, that will be cleaner, greener, and more prosperous. An economy which will bring more good, well-paying jobs. And Matthias was already talking to the head of the engineering department to look at some internship in people, because talent is really the key currency of today. And an economy where Canada, in the words of the Prime Minister, is leading when it comes to the car of the future. This project will fill a critical gap, and I think for all of those who are here today, this is so critical. This is a critical gap we're filling in the Canadian electric vehicle ecosystem. With today's announcement, we are reshoring a key stage of the battery making process. This is obviously good news for the folks here in the Kingston region. It's good news for the thousands of auto workers in our country, and it's good news for Canada, because for me, this is a big vote of confidence in our ability to attract key investment. In fact, as you may have seen over the last few months, we've attracted together tens of billions of dollars of investment and secured tens of thousands of good jobs. It's now, I think, Minister Fedeli and Prime Minister, it's fair to say that we've put the auto sector on a strong footing for generations to come with investment like LG and Stellantis in Windsor. We have seen Honda in Alliston. We've seen BASF in Bécancour. We have seen GM in Oshawa and countless other. As one CEO recently told me, he said, Canada is on a roll. And that's really what we want the world to take note of. And this is a vote of confidence in Canada, but also, I would say, a vote of confidence in our workers. And I want to thank them, because we could not be here if it was not for the talent, the expertise, and know-how of thousands of workers that led us to where we are today, because it's really them. The first thing that Matthias asked me, and you can ask him, is, do you have enough talent? Do you have the ecosystem? Do you have the resources? Do we have the renewable energy? That's what made the investment of Umicore possible. Indeed, this project speaks to the confidence that Umicore has in Canada and to our commitment to building a world-class domestic EV supply chain and battery ecosystem. For those who don't know Umicore perhaps as much as I do, Umicore is the leading and the largest cathode manufacturer in the world outside of Asia. And the fact that they have chosen Canada for their North American operations speaks volumes about the quality that we can provide here in Canada, and I'm very proud for that. And I can tell you, the world is taking notice of what we are creating here in Canada, because what Matthias and his team will be doing here, Prime Minister, the cathode active material and the precursor will be serving for 1 million electric vehicles in North America. So that's a very significant piece. And that's why when I was in Japan last week, I shared that with the team at Umicore. The Japanese automaker were telling me it's no longer why Canada, but how Canada. And this is our job to make sure that we facilitate that as we've done. So in closing, I want to thank Umicore for being such a great partner, and you, Matthias, chiefly for that. Your leadership vision and partnership was exemplary. With today's announcement, we see that you are committing to a long-term future for Canada. Let me say this is phase one, and we're very much looking forward to the rest. So let's seize the moment, let's be ambitious, and let's build a car of the future right here in Canada. Merci tout le monde. And with that, sorry, my distinguished colleague, now, the floor is to my distinguished colleague, Minister Fedeli, which is a great partner from the province of Ontario. Vic, floor is yours.
Thank you, François. It's always a lot of fun when we get together. That goes without saying. Prime Minister, welcome. Every time we get together, there's a big investment for the province of Ontario. Ambassador, MPP Rick Breese, MP Shelby Cramp. Thanks, everybody, for being here today. This is, as you have heard several times already today, this really is an historic announcement. So on behalf of Premier Doug Ford and the Government of Ontario, we say to you, Matthias, thank you for investing in the EV revolution that's taking place here in Ontario. Welcome. Now, I know I don't keep as detailed records as my friend François. I don't know that the last time we talked was 7:26 in the morning, but I will say we are looking forward to meeting your team in Belgium next Wednesday, so we can thank them all for working with our team so closely over the last several months, and we're really looking forward to meeting them face-to-face next Wednesday. So thank you very much. This is, as you have heard, a massive investment for the people of Ontario. As our province continues to add to this impressive run, $14 billion in auto investments together in the last 18 months. It's very exciting for Canada. It's particularly exciting for Ontario. From day one, our government has been unwavering in our commitment to protect the future of Ontario's auto sector and the thousands of workers and families that that auto sector supports right across the province. And what a day it is for the people of Loyalist Township. Today's once-in-a-generation announcement marks another major milestone in our commitment to the future of Ontario's automotive sector, which we call our Driving Prosperity Plan. And that plan includes all stages. If you think about the critical minerals in Northern Ontario, the green steel that is now coming out of, will now come out of Hamilton for the autos, EV batteries, which we announced, the tool makers, the die makers, the mold makers, all of the parts makers who are found all through Ontario, the autonomous, the connected and autonomous technology that we have centres all through Ontario, and of course the five OEMs who are building EVs and hybrids here. And now, with the support, we can proudly add Umicore's massive investment to this growing list. But this is really the game changer. First of all, it's a $1.5 billion investment to build North America's first industrial scale cathode and precursor materials manufacturing plant. That's what this announcement is all about, and it's right here in Eastern Ontario. But most importantly, it was the missing component, and you think of that whole supply chain from critical mineral right through to the finished vehicle coming off an assembly line. This is like dropping that final piece of the puzzle right in that creates a beautiful EV revolution picture in Ontario. This investment is also generational in scope, representing a major step towards Ontario's goal to develop a vertically integrated battery supply chain in the province, able to support large-scale EV production all through North America. This project, as you've heard the Prime Minister say, it also aligns with our critical mineral strategy that we announced in March. It will harness the mineral wealth of Northern Ontario and connect it with the manufacturing might of the South. So I'm a Northern boy. I have to put a plug in and say, you know, this is the first time Northern Ontario will be part of the auto sector in 120 years. So this is that interlocutor, that missing piece. Since taking office, as I said, we've been working to unleash Ontario's economic potential, attract new game-changing investments, along with Minister François Champagne. We work on these things so wonderfully, things like Umicore, making Ontario the place to do business once again. And I will take two lines here and talk about a little bit about the how. You know, when we first got elected, we lowered taxes, we reduced electricity costs, and we reduced red tape. And those steps and others brought the cost of doing business down by $7 billion every year. And that's a significant factor in why all of these $14 billion came to Ontario. So today's announcement sends yet another signal to the global community that Ontario is the perfect place for investment and growth. So to everyone at Umicore, we're proud that you chose Loyalist Township to make this historic investment. But this announcement goes beyond Eastern Ontario. It impacts communities across the province where we have the critical minerals and the cathode active material. And this investment illustrates, as Minister Champagne said, a dedication to the economy of the future, to the hardworking people across Canada and across Ontario's automotive sector in every region. So to hear more about that, we'll now hear directly from Matthias Midrick. Thank you, Matthias.
Yeah, thank you very much, Prime Minister, Minister Champagne, Minister Fedeli, Ambassador, Deputy Mayor Hagedorn, MPP Breezy, Ms. Curran and the Invest in Canada team, thank you very much. A great job done, as we have said. Dear guests here in Kingston and online, I was very happy to hear a lot of discussion about how to create a better future in Canada, but also how to decarbonize the supply chain of the electric vehicle, which at the end is what we want to do. An electric vehicle should be carbon-free, not only while driving, but from the beginning. And in Canada, we all aligned, and I heard the word partnership at the beginning. We are partners in that conviction, and we are very happy to contribute to that with today's announcement. I'm very excited, proud, and honored to announce our plans, Umicore's plans, to build what we call a gigafactory for battery materials. That is the critical element in a battery. So battery materials, for all of you that might not be so familiar with that, is the critical component, around 50% of the CO2 emissions, the cost, the performance of a battery is coming from that. So we are enabling that as a missing link, as you said it, to close the loop altogether of the battery materials supply chain. And this is already recognized by our customers. And as we said, probably after this announcement, my phone will ring a lot. And I'm very happy about that to support them in their transformation towards sustainable mobility. This planned gigafactory will be the first of its kind in North America, as already pointed out, because it's going the full way. It's not only doing the end product, which is the cathode material, it's integrated, as we say, from mine to battery, including all the upscale steps. PCAM is the first of this. PCAM is the precursor of this material. But we already talk about ambitions, plans, and studies, how to include refining and, to close the loop, recycling at a certain later step into the equation. And with that, it's truly the missing link between Canada's natural resources and the electric mobility value chain. Investing in Canada is for us the best equation to drive our North American business forward. It's the resource availability, it's the clean energy, and especially, I'm more than convinced after visiting here today, it's the availability of critical talent, of know-how and technological savviness that will help us to drive further our plans. We have decided this project, especially in Ontario, as we have identified exactly these criteria here. And as already pointed out, this new plant in the construction phase will have creation of more than 1,000 jobs and several hundred highly skilled workforce employments in operations. We as Umicore, we see ourselves as the circular materials company, and you see already in the name, circular is a very important part of that. We are a pioneer in battery materials. We have been doing that since the late 90s of the previous century already. We are a historic company. We're over 200 years old. And with that, we see ourselves also with a certain responsibility to be a key enabler in the decarbonization of the supply chain, having been a mining company ourselves long time ago. We are most grateful to the Canadian and the Ontario governments for their support in this regards, for their readiness to co-fund this planned project, but also for the alignment of the goals, as I have said it earlier already. I would like to really personally thank the team of Invest in Canada, who have driven, from our point of view, a best-in-class, a benchmark process for a company like ours to go forward. My whole team has told me that it's really in the history of projects, and we have been doing quite some projects in our 200 years history. That was really outstanding, and I would like to thank the whole team for that. We are now looking forward to a fruitful collaboration with the Loyalist Township and the County of Lennox and Eddington. Well, that is actually, I'm very excited this afternoon. We will go to the actual site and see where the new gigafactory will be constructed. I'm confident that Canada and the Ontario province have all that it takes to build the supply chain with the lowest CO2 equation in North America. And my team and I look now forward to turn our joint plans into concrete projects to establish this full-fledged supply chain for battery mobility in Canada. Together, we will make that transformation happen. Thank you very much, and it's my pleasure now to hand over to MPP Breezy for the next step. Thank you very much.
What an exciting day for all of us. And as this project will be developed in virtually my own backyard, in the riding of Hastings, Lennox, and Addington that I share with the federal MP, Shelby Cramp Nyman. And I'm thrilled to be here today and thrilled to have the Prime Minister here so that I can express our appreciation. And this project came about because of your leadership, the leadership of Minister Champagne, Minister Fedeli from the Provincial Ministry of Economic Development, Job Creation, the whole team, Invest in Canada, everyone has put this together. These investments show our shared collaborative commitment to building a supply chain for EVs. And while this investment is important for the country and for the province, it's a huge economic shot in the arm for the local region. This new project, adding significantly to the battery supply chain, is a huge step forward to ensuring that our future is sustainable. Canada is at the forefront of battery technology, and this will be a massive step forward in moving toward improving our climate footprint with technology that can be deployed around the world. For me personally, this is a tremendous moment. I'm so proud of the work that's been done at Loyalist Township and the County of Lennox and Addington. I want to especially focus on the highlights of a few individuals, actually. And our CAO, Mr. Steve Silver, and our director, MJ Merritt, the director of economics for the county, Mr. Stephen Paul. They've all done a fantastic job in bringing this here today. Thank you. And to the deputy mayor, who kind of got thrown into the deep end on this when his mayor ran off to another level of government. So thank you. You have all shown yourselves to be dedicated and innovative professionals. This is a day of celebration that you have truly earned. And to the entire Umicore team, Mateus, you are world leaders in mineral technologies. And we want to welcome you to Loyalist Township. I know that you will thrive here, and I know that you will come to love it as much as we do. Thank you very much for being here. At this time, I'd like to introduce the Deputy Mayor of Loyalist Township, Mr. Jim Hagedorn.
Good morning, everyone. As Deputy Mayor of Loyalist Township, I would like to thank Umicore for selecting our community as a location for their North American cathode active material facility. Although this is a historic day for Loyalist Township, this project represents a huge economic boost for our regional economy, and we are very proud that Loyalist Township is able to make a significant contribution to the EV battery sector value chain and the electrification revolution. I would like to thank the staff of Loyalist Township and of the County of Lennox and Addington, along with my fellow council members and MPP Rick Brzee, who spent a great deal of time developing a strong relationship with Umicore over the past 9 months. The values of both our organizations align very well. We both are committed to openness, innovation, respect, teamwork, and stability. This important investment announcement is a result of a multi-governmental team working effectively together. I'd like to thank Invest in Canada, along with the Ontario Ministry of Economic Development, Job Creation, and Trade. Their significant contributions made this project possible. Economic development is a priority for Loyalist Township and the County of Lennox and Addington. We have worked extremely hard to establish a proactive business environment. Our geography, infrastructure, access to skilled talent combined to make Loyalist a desirable location for economic development. I believe today's announcement and investment by Umicore validates this. Thank you, CEO, Mateus Miedrich, and the entire Umacore team for placing your trust in our community. This is an extremely exciting day for Loyalist Township and for Umacore. Thank you.
So let me close by thanking you all once again for coming to this exciting event today. I'd just like to say also that as a university, we share that responsibility for a low carbon future, and we look forward to the future working together. There are refreshments to the South End, and again, it was a pleasure hosting everyone today. I'd like now to invite Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, who will take questions, I believe, from the media. And the rest of the party.
Thank you all. We will now start the media availability. One question, one follow-up for 20 minutes. Une question, une sous-question pour 20 minutes, en donnant le micro à Radio-Canada.
Bonjour, Monsieur le Premier ministre, Valérie Gamache. Vous savez que la Banque du Canada a aussi son taux directeur à 2,5 %. L'inflation est à 7,7 %. Et là, je comprends que vous allez me dire qu'il y a des programmes qui sont en place pour aider les Canadiens et les Canadiennes, mais même les banques alimentaires crient famine actuellement. Est-ce qu'on est rendu au point où il faut mettre en place des programmes spéciaux, un peu peut-être comme vous avez fait pendant la pandémie pour ce qui est de la PCU, pour vraiment aider les Canadiens?
Écoutez, on sait à quel point ça fait beaucoup de conversations que j'ai avec les Canadiens d'un bout à l'autre de ce pays de ces dernières semaines et ces derniers mois, où les gens me soulignent qu'effectivement, c'est difficile de rejoindre les deux bouts avec l'inflation, qui est un phénomène mondial. On en a beaucoup discuté d'ailleurs lors de mes rencontres à l'international pour contrer cette réalité qui fait face à laquelle font face nos citoyens, mais aussi particulièrement les gens dans le monde en voie de développement. Comme on l'a toujours fait, on va être là pour les Canadiens. On est là avec de l'aide aux familles, on est là avec de l'aide aux aînés. On va continuer de regarder tout ce qu'on peut faire pour contrer ces impacts. Mais en même temps, une des meilleures choses qu'on doit faire, c'est de créer des bons emplois et de créer de la croissance économique. Et c'est exactement ce qu'on est en train de démontrer ici, que malgré les défis dans le monde amenés par la pandémie, par la crise climatique, par d'autres enjeux comme la guerre en Ukraine, on va continuer à investir maintenant pour créer de la stabilité, de l'opportunité pour les familles, pour avoir des bons emplois. Au niveau des emplois, on reconnaît que, oui, la pandémie a été difficile en termes de perte d'emplois, mais on a maintenant retrouvé plus de 115 % des emplois qu'on avait perdus en février 2020. Les États-Unis, par exemple, en ont juste retrouvé 96 %. Alors, la reprise économique est forte au pays, mais c'est pour ça, et ça continue d'être une raison et une façon avec laquelle on va être là pour aider les familles qui font face à des difficultés. On est toujours là pour eux.
Dans un autre dossier...
Obviously, in the conversations I've had with Canadians over the past weeks and months, I've heard it every step of the way that the cost of living hikes are a challenge. This global inflation crisis, which is hitting hard around the world, I mean, we talked about it a lot during our summits over the past few weeks internationally, particularly hitting hard in the global south, but we see a confluence of factors, whether it's the war in Ukraine, whether it's the ongoing pandemic, the disruption on supply chains, or even climate pressures. We know that families are struggling. And that's why, as a government, we made a promise to have people's backs, and we've continued to, with investments to support families, including by cutting childcare costs in half, by stepping up with increases in the CCB, in support for seniors, continuing to invest in students and in young people being able to afford their educations. But it's also why announcements like this here today that show the creation of good, sustainable, not just greener jobs, but greener careers in communities right across the country is making a difference. Canada has an opportunity to create even further economic increases. We've already seen great job creation over the past number of months. We're back at about 117 % of the jobs we lost in February 2020. The United States isn't even at 100% yet. They're still at 96% of jobs recovered. So the Canadian economic recovery is strong. But yes, Canadians need further support, and we'll continue to be there for them.
Et la prochaine question, je vais vous demander d'entrée de jeu de répondre en français puis en anglais. Radio-Canada a annoncé ce matin qu'il allait en appeler donc de la décision du CRTC de blâmer la société d'État pour avoir utilisé le mot en haine dans une émission de radio. Radio-Canada va aussi s'excuser là, auprès du plaignant. Je sais que vous allez me dire qu'il en revient de la décision du CRTC, il en revient de la décision de Radio-Canada, mais vous, vous situez-vous dans ce débat-là qui est extrêmement sensible actuellement?
C'est un débat extrêmement important, mais extrêmement complexe. Oui, nous devons à tout prix toujours protéger pas seulement la liberté d'expression, mais la capacité des médias de faire leur travail. En même temps, il faut comprendre qu'il y a des mots qui sont extrêmement blessants pour certains, qui sont lourds de portée, de signification. Et il faut avoir des conversations extrêmement importantes sur comment on va naviguer ces deux facettes importantes. On va toujours être là pour défendre la liberté d'expression et l'importance de l'indépendance journalistique. Mais nous devons aussi être sensibles au fait qu'il y a des mots qui ont une lourdeur historique significative qui continue aujourd'hui à être blessante, que nous devons continuer d'avoir des conversations difficiles en société. Il n'y a pas de réponse facile à ça, mais les conversations qu'on est en train d'avoir sont la façon qu'on va passer à travers. I think it's extremely important to underline that defending freedom of expression, defending journalistic independence and integrity is always going to be a foundation, not just of Canada, but of any strong democracy. We have to be stepping up for that. At the same time, there are words that carry deep, deep historical and current weight to them that cause harm. And as a society, how we have thoughtful conversations about how we navigate through that, how we make sure, yes, we're standing up for freedom of expression, but yes, we're avoiding perpetuating deep societal injustices and crimes. That's the challenge that, quite frankly, there's no simple answer to, but the path we're all taking as a society of talking about it, trying to figure out how that best way forward is what we're going to continue to do in a reasonable, responsible way.
Next question.
Morning, Mia Rabson from the Canadian Press. Canada has recently decided to agree to Germany's request to send a gas turbine back. We're learning now that this is a deal that will last for 2 years. It could involve multiple gas turbines, but going back and forth. President Zelensky says that this is unacceptable. What do you say to him? What do you say to the Ukrainian people? What do you say to the Ukrainian-Canadian Congress, who is now taking you to court over it? When you say you stand with Ukraine, are there no other options?
Canada has been one of the strongest countries in the world in standing with Ukraine, in being there to support President Zelensky and the heroic fighting that people in Ukraine are doing, not just to defend their homeland against an illegal, unjustifiable, horrific invasion by Russia, but they're also standing up for the values and principles that, that underlie our democracies and the rule of law and territorial integrity and sovereignty. So yes, Canada will continue to be there unequivocally to stand with Ukraine. So this was a very difficult decision. But we have seen Russia consistently trying to weaponize energy as a way of creating division amongst the allies, of undermining the general population's support for this essential effort in Ukraine that governments continue to support. And I remind people that the sanctions that Canada's leading on, that we continue to push harder and harder, are aimed at Putin and his enablers and aren't designed to harm our allies and their populations. This decision to be there to support Germany and Europe in the real challenges they face around energy, particularly over the coming year as they work as fast as they can to get off their reliance of Russian oil and gas is an essential piece in ensuring that not just governments across Europe and around the world, but populations in our countries continue to support their governments stepping up with billions of dollars of support in military and financial and humanitarian support for the Ukrainian people while they lead this essential fight against tyranny and oppression. Tout d'abord, je vais réitérer que le Canada demeure un des pays les plus farouchement alignés avec l'Ukraine, là pour les appuyer avec des milliards de dollars en appui économique, militaire et humanitaire, et on va continuer de l'être. Alors, cette décision a été une décision difficile, mais on doit se souvenir que les sanctions qu'on a mis de l'avant, sur lesquelles le Canada est parmi les plus forts dans le monde, sont là pour punir Poutine et ses amis et pas pour punir nos alliés et les populations de l'Europe. Or, la Russie est en train de faire tout son travail non seulement pour diviser les alliés entre eux, mais pour faire de l'énergie une arme pour enlever de l'appui pour l'Ukraine. On sait que l'Allemagne et d'autres pays en Europe font face à une crise énergétique, sinon pas la capacité d'avoir ce gaz naturel. Et donc, nous allons continuer d'être là pour nos alliés pendant qu'ils font le travail essentiel de rapidement, le plus rapidement possible, dans les années à venir, enlever leur dépendance sur le pétrole et le gaz russe.
On inflation, when the Bank of Canada's decision today, some are suggesting, is a sign that they're expecting inflation to last a lot longer than maybe had been hoped. You just said that you know Canadians need more help than have already been offered. What else are you likely to put on the table? Most other G7 countries have directly cut gas taxes or offered rebates. Critics have asked you to cut the GST or give a bigger GST rebate to people. What exactly are you likely to put on the table?
We know that inflation and the disruptions caused in the energy markets by the war in Ukraine require us to take action. And yes, to take action as we have on supporting families directly, including by cutting childcare costs in half right across the country this year. But there is more to do, and part of that more to do is to make sure that our economy moves forward in a way that is less dependent on fossil fuels. That's where investments like we're announcing today in historic creations of electric vehicle manufacturing plants and supply chains are going to keep our economy growing with better jobs as Canadians face disrupted supply chains around the world that we can then rely on more and more right here in Canada and within our allies. There's a lot of work to do, but there are also tremendous opportunities for Canadians to get better jobs, for Canada's economy to grow in ways that are sustainable, not just on the environmental side, but sustainable through the coming generations of transformation in the world, and that's what we're going to stay focused on.
Next question.
Good morning, Prime Minister Rafi Bujikanian, CBC News. I'll ask you to please answer the first question in English and French. So the Conference of Premiers is pretty upset with you over healthcare transfers. Alberta Premier Jason Kenney says you're just ragging the puck, that you have no intention at all of increasing the share of pay from the federal government. BC Premier Don Horgan asks, where has the love gone? Why are you ghosting the premiers on this issue?
I don't think there is a prime minister in Canadian history who, over the entire scope of their time in office, has met with the premiers and sat down to talk about health care as much as I have over the past 2 years. We will, of course, continue to work together because there are real pressures faced by Canadians, faced by our health care systems across the country. I've been speaking with nurses and doctors across the country, families who are faced real difficulties in getting primary care doctors, getting a family doctor, getting access to the surgeries that were put off during the pandemic, and a serious need for more investments in mental health supports And we know this pandemic has been incredibly difficult. And being able to be there to deliver concretely appointments and support for people who are reaching out to say, I need help, who don't want to hear, okay, maybe 6 months from now, maybe a year from now, we can get you an appointment. We need to not just invest dollars into healthcare, which we've committed to doing, which we've done to the tune of $72 billion of extra funding in healthcare over the past 2 years, on top of the tens of billions we send every year in healthcare transfers. So yes, the federal government's going to be there, but our focus every step of the way, and Canadians right across the country in every province will understand this, is making sure that those dollars that we put in deliver real, tangible results for Canadians in shorter wait times, in better services, in access to a family doctor. And that's what we've been pushing on, and that's what we're continuing to talk with the provinces about, because people know there have been huge investments in healthcare made by provinces and governments and federal governments in the past that haven't always delivered the improvements to healthcare that is necessary. And coming out of this pandemic, we have an opportunity to not just invest more, which we will, but to make sure that those investments are felt by families, felt by seniors, felt by people who need services and mental health, but also felt by those heroes in the system, the nurses, doctors, orderlies, and hospital workers who've been stretched thin, burned out, challenged by this. Yes, the federal government will be there to invest in healthcare, but we are going to make sure that those investments deliver for Canadians.
En français.
Ah oui, en français. Je vais raccourcir un petit peu. Ça fait des semaines et des mois que j'entends très clairement des Canadiens à quel point les chirurgies qui ont été reportées pendant la pandémie ont besoin d'accès à des services en santé mentale. Et oui, le gouvernement fédéral a été là pour rencontrer les provinces plus souvent que n'importe quel autre premier ministre dans l'histoire du pays. Et on va continuer de le faire. On a aussi été là pour investir 72 milliards de dollars d'extra au cours des deux dernières années en soins de santé, parce qu'on sait à quel point c'est important, et on va continuer d'être là pour investir. Mais je pense que tous les Canadiens comprennent que c'est pas juste de pitcher de l'argent vers le problème qu'ils veulent résoudre, on a besoin de démontrer des résultats concrets, des Canadiens qui vont trouver enfin un médecin de famille, des Canadiens qui vont pouvoir avoir leur chirurgie, des Canadiens qui sont en détresse, qui vont pouvoir avoir un rendez-vous sur la santé mentale en dedans de quelques jours. Ou à ce niveau-là, on a du travail à faire, puis c'est ça les conversations qu'on est en train d'avoir avec les provinces. Comment livrer pour les citoyens?
Thanks. And on Statistics Canada's new census figures, we're seeing that more Canadians than ever before are living alone, and the fastest growing type of household is one with roommates. So how do you plan to make sure your housing policies evolve to reflect this trend?
Well, one of the things that we knew when we actually restored the long-form census after the previous Conservative government decided to cut it was we need to make decisions based on good data, on what's actually happening in communities across the country. And as we make historic investments in housing, particularly in partnership with municipalities to increase the opportunities and the investments in housing so that people in small rural areas, in our biggest cities, and everyone in between gets better access to housing, we're doing it from a foundation of knowledge and information, and building policy based on data and facts is something that Canadians are understanding is essential in the way forward.
Next question.
Kimberly Johnson with CTV News. The Bank of Canada increased rates yet again today, and many economists are saying that if rates keep going up, Canada is headed for a recession. Are you concerned Canada is headed into a recession?
Of course, the Bank of Canada makes its decisions independently and is working very hard to counter inflation. At the same time, however, we have to highlight, as I said earlier, how the Canadian economy has recovered and bounced back from the pandemic. Faster than the United States, we've recovered 117% of the jobs we lost since February 2020, when the United States has only recovered about 96% of the jobs lost since the beginning of the pandemic. And that is a direct credit to Canadians themselves, who followed public health rules, who kept themselves and their neighbors safe, and who were there to support people, yes, with government support, that managed to leave us in a better position, not just in terms of health outcomes through the pandemic, but in terms of economic outcomes bouncing back. We know there are global forces at play, whether it be disruption in supply chains, the war in Ukraine and the challenges around energy from Russia, whether it be the pressures of climate change, whether it be disrupted supply chains. These are things that we are working hard with our partners around the world to counter, to prevent downturns. But at the same time, we're continuing to step up to support Canadians, including by announcing investments like the one here today that are going to make a huge difference here in this part of Ontario, with both construction jobs and good quality long-term jobs in Loyalist Township that will have spillovers to Kingston and Queens. These are things that create and ensure that regardless of fluctuations at the highest level of the economy, Canadians can know there are good jobs there for them, there's a good future for them, for their kids, and the community they live in. That's what this announcement today is about, and that's what this vote of confidence by one of the largest companies in the world in terms of battery manufacturing of cathodes is making in Canadians themselves.
Following up.
President Zelensky had very strong words for your government, saying that it was absolutely unacceptable that Canada would allow Gazprom to get back a turbine used in the Nord Stream 1 pipeline. Why did your government offer a special permit for this turbine, which would effectively allow Russia to continue to profit off oil and gas?
Like I said, Canada remains one of the strongest allies to Ukraine, friends to Ukraine. We have been there with economic support in the billions of dollars, significant armament, and we continue to. But we're not alone. Countries in Europe, particularly Germany, have stepped up massively in their support of Ukraine as well. And we need to hold together, particularly faced with the attempts by Russia to weaponize energy policy, to divide us amongst ourselves. We will continue to stand up ever stronger sanctions, but remember that those sanctions are aimed not at our allies, but at Putin and his cronies. And that's exactly why we took this difficult decision to be there for our allies, to ensure that in Europe, not just governments, but populations stay steadfast and generous in their support of Ukraine and of the extremely important fight that President Zelensky and Ukrainians are leading, not just to defend their own territory, but to defend the underpinnings of our democracies.
We'll take one last question.
Steph Crozier from Kingston Whig Standard. I wanted to ask about the plant itself. What stood out about Loyalist in particular, and did we beat out any other locations?
I can tell you at a high level, and then I'll turn over to the others. François-Philippe pointed it out, but the world is noticing that Canada is on a roll in terms of electric vehicles manufacturing. We have been stepping up with big announcements, most of them partnership with the Ontario government, that are covering the entire supply chain. And people have realized that from the critical minerals and the mining expertise we have, which we do better and cleaner than just about any other country in the world, all the way to the high quality manufacturing jobs that we have scattered across the country, to the proximity to assembly plants and customers, Canada is a very exciting place to invest, and not just because of recent investments, but our tradition of greener aluminum than just about anywhere else in the country, investments recently in greener steel, in a grid that is already over 80% renewable for our energy and electricity. These are things that are drawing and comparing very favorably to other jurisdictions around the world. And it's really been a lot of hard work by a number of governments working together to position Canada in this global leadership place. But I'm happy to turn perhaps to Mathias to say a few words on this. Yeah,
thank you very much, Prime Minister. I couldn't have said it better, actually, what have been the reasons. And thank you very much for that question. So the availability, there are three main things that made this decision happen. The first one is availability of clean energy. This is the true thing we want to do if we build an electric vehicle, as I said earlier, and that's check for Canada and also check for Ontario. The second one is the availability of resources where Canada has, in North America, really a unique position. So check for the second one. And the third one was the availability of talent, critical talent, and here especially the area, Loyalist Township, Kingston, with all of the things we have seen and that I have seen here today, where the decisive checkbox to be checked that brought us here today.
Following up.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're hired.
Thank you.
And I was going to ask, it doesn't. How is the? You were saying that the manufacturing plants can be 100% clean. How is that possible for a massive facility?
Yeah, it's possible because this kind of manufacturing, so the cathode active material, is the prime energy that is used is electricity. So it's not an emitting or highly, we're not burning things or stuff like that. So it's clean energy that is used. And we have just launched in Europe, we will actually launch in 2 weeks, our first gigafactory in Poland. Also there we have 100% renewable energy that's coming from wind. There is a different mix and even a much more favorable mix in Canada. So that's why we will use this energy, so our so-called scope 2 emissions, that we will secure with the respective long-term agreements that we have already laid out are totally possible here in Ontario. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone. Merci beaucoup.